Yes, and they have complained and said that our hour of need, you abandoned us.
But rather than that, we could send health workers as being proposed. We can send finances. We can have the whole world bring in equipment. But the best hope for the world is to control Ebola in the countries where they exist. And if you had direct flights, there's a possibility that one of those people coming in from Liberia would have Ebola, and by the time you pick it up, it's too late. And I think that's not a risk we should willingly embrace as a people. It's not because you're not elderly, but because you just have to be prudent and make wise decisions.
Many have argued that the world perhaps did not seriously take this in the initial breakout, that it is now that everybody is realizing, wow, it is getting out of hand, and more concerted efforts from around the globe coming together to help. Is it correct, that assessment, that perhaps the West African countries were left on their own for far too long, and that more attention, as each country prepares and protects itself, needs to be ensuring that they're perhaps helping out there as well? Because if that is not sorted out, then everyone continues to remain in danger.
Absolutely. And Sophie, one of the things that is really worrying to me, last week I just received on the social media, I don't know whether Dr. you've come across this, but the Center for Infectious Disease Research and Policy, CIDRAP, at the University of Minnesota, I just told him with this idea that actually Ebola could be airborne. And you see, this is strongly suggested by some of case studies that have been done in the past, that we have had cases where people have contracted Ebola, or study apes have contracted Ebola without contact. And this raises a lot of concern. It raises a lot of issues that everybody, including the Western countries, we must do more than. Because as we're speaking now, people are saying direct contact is the surest way. And if you have abrasions and things like that, if you're injected with the blood that has got the Ebola virus, these are. But there are certain, like the American nurse who got this, all the protocols were supposed to have been observed. Now they are querying, maybe they didn't. But if you look at it critically, maybe there is a transmission mode that has not been understood, and the University of Minnesota, through some of their researchers, are postulating that it could be, actually there's a chance that Ebola is airborne, and that could be very scary. It means even here locally, as we talk about preparedness, then they could.
When you only have one hand, you're not doing anything as fast as you used to.
I don't know if you just heard that, but I'm pretty sure they just said Ebola is airborne.
In the apes, it's confirmed. Then in 1995, there was a case in DRC where a patient underwent surgery, an Ebola patient, and all the health personnel contracted the disease, and the way they contracted this was it was airborne transmission through what we call aerosolized fluid. So this is confirmed. The only thing is that the transmission is not as aggressive in humans, and it's not been documented beyond that case in DRC. Now, obviously, look at the cases as they are, then that possibility of airborne transmission is actually very valid, and I wouldn't be surprised if the current research by Minnesota team comes up with it.
Yeah,
so it's definitely an area of concern as well.
All right, we want to listen to a doctor from Liberia who apparently uses HIV drugs to cure Ebola. Let's hear what he has to say.
Started to treat people in the form of an experimental study, a medication referred to as lamivudine. This medication is an antiviral drug. In 1988, it was invented in the U.S. Initially, they used it to treat people with viral hepatitis, especially hepatitis B virus. It was tested on the first patient, and then the patient survived. The second, the patient, they also survived. The third, and we went up to about 15, you know, cases that this medication was tried on. Out of that number, 13 of them survived. Two died. Even the two that died, you know, had other comorbidity. The other patient was a known heart failure patient before the Ebola caught him. And the other person was a known hypertensive.
Beginning. Okay, what do you have to say to that, Lori?
Well, I mean, is like he rightly says, is doing it on an experimental basis. Mm-hmm. So it is not something that is confirmed. But Ebola being a virus, I mean, you could try any antiretroviral. So you, it would not be surprising if some of the HIV drugs could have show some effects on the Ebola virus. The one thing that is very different from the Ebola virus is that it attacks a lot of the body cells. If you look at HIV or other viruses, they attack specific cells. If you look at like the hepatitis virus that is saying, it specifically attacks the liver cells. But the Ebola virus, why even the fatalities are very high, is that it attacks epithelial cells almost all over the body.
Mm.
And that makes it even more complex. So so that a lot of routine HIV drugs would actually kill the patient faster because it will be destroying almost all the cells.
Okay.
Yeah.
In fact, right now there's a lot of research going into Ebola, and we are seeing a lot of novel ideas coming out. I'm not surprised by what the doctor says, because one of the categories that has been identified are called nucleoside analog drugs. These are usually part of the HIV regimen. And there's a very big study that has shown promise in the use of antiretrovirals towards treating Ebola, meaning that particular group of drugs. So this is possibly what is being witnessed, and there's a very good chance that could be true. Beyond this, there's a vaccine that is promising, and WHO projects that we'll have millions of these by the end of next year. Now, there's something we said earlier. Were we slow to respond to Ebola? Of course you were, because in Guinea, there's Ebola by the end of 2013, and the very first time WHO spoke about Ebola was in March 2014.
Mm.
That is more than 3 months later, actually more than 4 months later, it got out of hand at that point.
Right.
Treatment-wise, there's a lot of promise that there could be a vaccine available and a various treatment options.
Talk about it, what happened to what cured these two doctors in the U.S., this medication that they took and what, like,
Zimap.
Charm? Yes.
Zimap. Now, I think that's what I'm trying to say. If you look up to the doctors in the United States who treated the patients, they said,